From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Author Interviews. Conversations with authors exploring the latest clinical research, reviews, and opinion featured in JAMA.
Hello and welcome to our listeners from around the world. I'm Dr. Preeti Malani, JAMA Deputy Editor. I'm joined today by Dr. Rajesh Gandhi. Dr. Gandhi is professor of medicine at Harvard Medical School. He's the lead author of the updated Antiretroviral Drugs for Treatment and Prevention of HIV Infection in Adults, 2024 recommendations of the International Antiviral Society USA panel, which was published online first in JAMA on December 1st, 2024. Raj, welcome.
It's great to be here. Thank you for having me.
Once again, JAMA was very intentional in selecting December 1st to publish the updated HIV treatment guidelines as a way to mark World AIDS Day and highlight the continued importance of HIV. Clinicians who don't spend a lot of time thinking about HIV or caring for patients living with HIV may not recognize just how much progress has been made in terms of treatment and prevention. Highly effective, well-tolerated, and convenient regimens are widely used today, both for treatment of HIV and prevention. So let's begin with treatment. Today, treatment is recommended regardless of CD4 count and should be started as soon as possible after diagnosis. Let's talk about some of the practicalities of starting treatment for HIV. How do you decide what regimen to use for a particular patient?
That's a great question. And what I start with a patient that I'm first meeting is just letting them know that HIV really has changed and that we can treat people effectively and that I anticipate they're going to live a long and healthy life and have, if they'd like, children, and if they'd like, they can plan on a healthy future. So I set that expectation early on. In terms of the regimen that I use, it's really mostly a one pill once a day combination now. So several medicines in one pill. The basis of HIV treatment right now is an integrase strand transfer inhibitor, a drug called dolutegravir or bictegravir, with a drug called tenofovir and either 3TC or FTC. That's three drug therapy, but there are options now for giving two drug therapy as well. Most of my patients, I'll start on three drugs in a single pill, and then sometimes I'll step down to two drugs. I do also counsel them once their viral load is undetectable, that they're not infectious sexually. So the idea of U equals U, if they're undetectable for their HIV, they're untransmissible. They won't transmit. And that's a relief to many of my patients. Two special situations I want to call out. If a person is either pregnant or trying to conceive, our guidelines recommend the use of dolutegravir plus FTC and tenofovir alafenamide. That's the one that I think has the best safety record. But a very popular regimen in the U.S. is bictegravir, FTC, and TAP. And we don't think you need to switch that regimen if someone becomes pregnant and is doing well on that regimen. And lastly, the other special situation that I really want to highlight for our listeners is that we now have injectable antiretroviral therapy. We didn't used to. But now we have, for people whose viral load is suppressed on a pill, on an oral regimen, we have cabotegravir rilpivirine, which is an injectable combination. It's given in the clinic that's every 2 months. And some of my patients who don't want to take a daily pill really prefer that injectable regimen.
Current treatments are better tolerated in terms of adverse effects, and virologic failure occurs much less frequently. When virologic failure does occur, it's often in the setting of poor adherence to oral medications. Clinically, how do you approach that scenario?
You know, you put your finger on it. I mean, most of my patients are doing quite well. They're on oral therapy or an injectable, and their viral load is undetectable, and they're in good health. But there are an important part of my patient panel and an important group that is struggling with adherence because of a variety of issues. So how do I approach that? I start by trying to understand the reasons for non-adherence. I try to understand, is it stigma? Is it that they're concerned about revealing their diagnosis to someone that they live with? Maybe they're taking a pill that they have to take with food and they eat their meals with family members. So I try to come up with a regimen that they can take without taking it with food. And there are good regimens that they can do that now. Or I talked about injectable antiretroviral therapy that would allow them to not have to take the medicine around someone else. So I talked to them about stigma. Sometimes it's cost. We know in the U.S. that there can be challenges around the cost of our drugs. And so I try to connect them with financial services or benefits managers. Many times it's mental health issues or depression. And I think I can't overemphasize the importance of treating depression, involving social workers, conferring and referring to psychiatry. And then the last area I explore is substance use disorder and making sure my patients have counseling and treatment In our guidelines, we spend a good amount of time with an expanded section around evidence-based treatment recommendations, including medicines for opiate use disorder and alcohol use disorder. And then the last innovation, I think, is in people who just cannot take an oral drug daily, there are now demonstration projects as well as a randomized trial called Latitude that shows that injectable antiretroviral therapy, that cabotegravir, rilpivirine, improves outcome. And I do recommend that conjoined with case management support and other support for people who are struggling to take an oral drug. So I think we have some ways to approach this.
Yeah, that gets at how complicated things can be for individuals and that one size doesn't fit all. So that's really helpful. With testing and early treatment, many people living with HIV can expect a normal lifespan. So beyond antivirals, the updated guideline highlights several general health issues. One area that we've seen new evidence is the primary prevention of cardiovascular disease. How have those results changed the 2024 guidelines?
So there's been a massive change in our approach to preventing cardiovascular disease. And I would say it's largely based on the landmark REPRIEVE study. This was a study that was done around the world that looked at almost 7,500 people, actually more than 7,500 people living with HIV, all of whom had low to moderate risk of developing cardiovascular disease using the ASCVD risk score, which we often use in projecting likelihood of heart disease. These individuals with HIV had a lower moderate risk. And people were randomized in that REPRIEVE study to either get placebo or a statin. And what we found out recently, within the last year or so, is that the statins reduced cardiovascular events like myocardial infarction, like stroke, by 35%. And that was a really meaningful improvement in outcomes. So as a result, our guidelines and others now recommend using statins in people with HIV who are over the age of 40 and who have an ASCVD score of greater than 5%. That's considered low to moderate risk. And if their ASCVD is less than 5%, they were still included in the study. And we do think that it's reasonable to consider statins even at a lower risk, especially if they have other independent risk factors for cardiovascular disease, things like low CD4 count nadir, use of older drugs that had metabolic effects, or long durations of viremia. The last thing I'll say briefly is that weight gain is an issue that has gotten a lot of attention in the HIV field because about 10% of people with HIV do gain excessive amounts of weight. When I mean excessive, I mean more than 10% of their ideal body weight. It's more common in women. It's more common in Black individuals. And it's been linked to some of our HIV drugs, but it appears that that link is because of our older drugs having more of a weight suppressant effect. So right now, and this is important for our listeners, right now, antiretroviral therapy should not be changed because of weight gain. Rather, what we would recommend is lifestyle modifications. And there are new data on the GLP-1 receptor agonist, particular for HIV. And I think that's going to be the future of in terms of managing weight gain and reducing cardiovascular risk.
I'll just add that that section of the guideline I thought was particularly well done, so encourage all our listeners to read it closely. So let's shift to prevention and pre-exposure prophylaxis, or PrEP. There is substantial evidence to support use of antivirals as prevention of HIV, but there are large numbers of people who could benefit from PrEP that are not getting it for a variety of reasons. What can be done to increase use of PrEP?
So that's such a good question. I mean, I would say that there are many prongs that we can take on this front. One is educating our patients and our colleagues in medicine about the use of PrEP, that pre-exposure prophylaxis is highly effective, underlined, highly effective in preventing HIV, close to 100% effective. Also, making sure that we and our colleagues are discussing PrEP with sexually active adolescents and adults, as well as anyone who injects non-prescription drugs. One thing I want to really make apparent is that we have several excellent PrEP options. So it's not a one-size-fit-all, as you said before. And I think one of these options will be right for the majority of our patients. So there's daily oral PrEP with tenofovir, disoproxil fumarate, TDF-FTC, or TAF-FTC. So daily pills is one option that's been around for a few years now. There's also what we call on-demand PrEP. That means PrEP around the time of a sexual exposure. That does have good data for it in men who have sex with men. We now have one injectable option today, and we think we're going to have another injectable option in the near future. The injectable option we have today is cabotegravir long-acting, given every 2 months. That's been FDA-approved for prevention of HIV. And then in really exciting news that we touch on the guidelines, but I imagine we'll be expanding in the future, another injectable called lenacapavir, which is a capsid inhibitor, administered every 6 months. Two big studies have come out. One's published, one's about to be published. These looked at lenacapavir every 6 months for prevention, and in cisgender women, there were no cases of HIV in women who got lenacapavir for prevention, and in men who have sex with men, and in transgender people, lenacapavir, and this has just been presented, but is about to be published, was more than 96% effective. So we have really good options. In terms of how to expand those options, we need to address those same barriers, cost, substance use disorder, stigma. But another novel approach is to do it in a decentralized way. Rather than make people come to us in a clinic, can we take PrEP to the people? Can we take it to places where people are getting sexual health care, for example, or other care that they may not come to our primary care clinics or HIV clinics? That's a novel approach that I think we'll see more of. The last area I'll highlight is sexually transmitted infections raise the likelihood of HIV acquisition. So there's a new tool that I know people are becoming aware of called doxycycline post-exposure prophylaxis. What do I mean by that? That means taking the antibiotic doxycycline after condomless sex, and it's been shown to reduce incidence of chlamydia and syphilis by 70 to 80%. So a really meaningful reduction, less of an effect on gonorrhea. And so we discuss who to use that and who to offer that to in these guidelines.
I want to close our conversation by talking about equity in HIV treatment and prevention. And there's been a lot of progress worldwide on the elimination of HIV. We have the tools to test, treat, and prevent HIV, but infections have not gone away. And in some groups, infections are increasing. Getting to zero remains an aspirational goal. As you look forward, what concerns you and what gives you hope?
Yeah, that's as we are on World AIDS Day, I think that's a great theme and an area to explore. So I'll lay out a couple of concerns, but also a couple of my hopes. So my first concern is that too many people, even now in 2024, about to be 2025, are diagnosed very late with HIV. About 20% of people in America are diagnosed with HIV with a CD4 count of less than 200, and that compromises their own health and also contributes to transmission. So I hope that by expanding testing and access to care, that we're going to get more people tested and diagnosed early. And if they don't have HIV, that we offer them PrEP, pre-exposure prophylaxis, with one of those options, what we call status neutral care. So that's one concern and hope. My second concern is that we've touched on it before. There are people who are just not able to take those excellent treatments that we started with because of stigma, cost, substance use disorder, mental health issues. And what I'm hoping is as we get more and more tools, new options, oral therapy, but also every 2 month therapy, every 6 month therapy to prevent HIV, that we're going to get the options lined up with what people's preferences are and what people's needs are. And I think a lot more can be still done to make those options available. And then last and maybe most in terms of the greatest concern that I have is because of inequities, the tools we have just won't be available to those at greatest needs. So I think my hope here is that we're going to expand access to new treatment and prevention tools in the U.S. In particular, we need to double down on the quest to end the HIV epidemic. The last administration before the one we're in now started that quest to end the HIV epidemic. And I hope that we accelerate that in the next administration. The pillars here are diagnose HIV, treat it, prevent it, and respond to outbreaks. And we need to have a workforce in HIV care that allows us to do all that. And then globally, I want to make sure we don't lose sight of the progress. When we started doing World AIDS Day, many people around the world weren't getting HIV treatment. Now, on today's World AIDS Day, there are more than 30 million people around the world who are getting antiretroviral therapy. And we have to give credit to national programs and global efforts like PEPFAR. And I hope in the years to come that we're going to make HIV treatment and prevention available to all. So that's my hope and dream. And I hope that 2 years from now, I'll come back and share thoughts on where we are with that dream.
Raj, thanks so much for joining me.
It's my pleasure. Thank you for having me.
I'm Dr. Preeti Malani, and I've been speaking with Dr. Rajesh Gandhi about the 2024 guidelines on treatment and prevention of HIV. You can find a link to the article in this episode's description. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com or search for JAMA Network wherever you get your podcasts. This episode was produced by Daniel Morrow at the JAMA Network. Thanks for listening.
This content is protected by copyright by the American Medical Association with all rights reserved, including those for text and data mining, AI training, and similar technologies.